Hello, I'm Mike Parsons, the CEO of QUALITANCE, and welcome to QUALITALKS. Yes, QUALITALKS is back, and we have a great webinar to share with you today. Lots and lots and lots of insights. I'm going to be talking with Marian Ignat, who is the head of retail distribution at BCR. He's been a good partner over many, many years, and it's really fun to sit down with him and share some of the experiences. And this is a great opportunity to learn from him and all the insights that he's learned along the way in creating and scaling digital product at an enterprise level. Now, in this webinar, we cover lots of great topics, including where do you start? Really putting customers at the heart of the process. We also talk about this transformation of digital from being what Marianne called exotic and making it essential. He's learned a lot along the way, including how you get everybody in the organization on board so everyone feels a deep sense of ownership and they can share in the success. So we've got lots of tips and insights around that. And just to wrap things up, he's also got a few thoughts on what he's thinking about next, what's in the future for him with emerging technologies. So stay tuned, this is a great session where we can learn from one of the best. Now, where we pick things up is I've just asked him the first question in the webinar, which is, where do we start?
The issue of the client and how to solve the problem of the client, but also to restart the process all over again. I think this is the most important thing. On the other hand, to scale up and to bring a product to, let's say, in a full rollout, I think it's important to plan not only from the infrastructure point of view, but more important from the business perspective, from the adoption point of view. You have to check all the time which are the adoption rate, what clients, what the issues that the clients face, and to fix it. And this is from the product perspective, but it's not so simple. You can imagine that it's a whole organization that you have to deal with. How there are many questions, how you'll put the whole organization to go in the same direction, how you change a non, let's say, exotic service. Mm. Let's face it, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, digital channels that were called alternative channels, and even the word alternative channels was something that is something exotic in the organization that they have to do something because it's cool, not because it's because helps the client, because it's cool, is you have to have it, it's good for the image. And transforming this alternative thing or cool thing or one particular area in something that becomes core of your business is very difficult to digest for any organization.
Let me ask you this question. I want to pick up on something you said there. It sounds like digital has gone from exotic to essential. Take us back in time, because you've in your position, you're looking at all touch points, although you have a digital background. So I think it's a fascinating question. When did you notice that us digital guys were no longer in the exotic corner, but it became essential? Is there a moment in time? Was there a technology? Take us back to when you were like, hang on, digital has just become essential.
Look, in my view, and I was head of digital, let's say now I'm head of distribution, digital is an artificial position. There is no such a thing, digital. What is your job? To be, to digitalize the process or to digital is a temporary, could be a temporary job in order to have a transition from one business model to the other. If everybody is doing his or her job right, there is no need for a digital unit or transformation unit. If the head of IT is doing the, in understand the current business landscape, it should bring all the technology in order to help the business guy to do more business or better serve their clients. On the other hand, also the business guys, if they want to be relevant and to really understand the current status and landscape of the business in the current days, they should understand that there is a technology around that clients are not going anymore to in a shop for simple transactions, and they expect this to be online or through a digital channel. So yeah, so I think we are in the position that, and I think also this is one of the reasons that I took this challenge to manage the whole distribution and the whole touch point of the bank, because I do believe that at the end of the day is you have to go back to the core of your business, what you are doing. You are providing financial services. Exactly. You are providing financial services now. That means you have to combine the brick and mortar and the contact center and the digital channels in a new experience. And that's it.
So earlier in this discussion, you talked a little bit about the sort of the ultimate truth is going to the client, the customer, the user. In this new role that you have, looking across all those touch points, what's your go-to metric or go-to tool if you want to know what customers need, if you want to know what challenges customers are facing, what you could do to improve the customer experience? Are there certain data points or processes that you use to get to that truth? How do you do it?
Yeah, apart from the, let's say, the classical research that we are doing, and this is done for years. So now we have the technology allows us to verify and check through the customer journey where are the pain points. And I think this is amazing that you can see in each and every step what is the pain point of the client, because until now the only thing that you could have was to have interviews with clients, to check with each and every client. Now you know from the data that you have on your platform which are the pain points and how to first to identify and second to fix it. What is challenging actually is now that we are in that move to start all the time new projects, to start new functionalities, to see what is missing, what is cool to offer, and what is new. You have all the time this, we are in the mood that we have to bring something new in the market. And this, I have this conversation with all the people around me and also with the journalists that they are asking me, and now what is next? What, George, what will bring next? What is the next feature? And yeah, we have to step back a little bit, go to the balcony and to see again the landscape and to think about it. Clients, they really need a new thing. So if there is, this is the answer, yes, yeah, you have to put all the efforts in that direction then to offer to the clients. On the other hand, you have to go back to see if the current the processes that were designed very well 1 year, 2 years ago, with design thinking methodology, with interviews, and everything was quite fine, is still relevant for the current status. Because look, now we have complex, let's say, very complex digital tools for the clients. They could do everything there, everything what they could imagine, let's say, or the most most range of product and services for the daily banking part, but still they are using the most frequent uses for checking the balance. This is the reality. So they and I'm doing incredible. Myself the same. I'm checking the balance to see if everything is cool. Everything, all my money are there. They are not, they are still there. But yeah, you have to check all, you have to take some time to recheck each and every service and product that you have. And this is coming back to your question, you have to follow the customer journey to see where the problem is.
So if I was to summarize, your advice to anyone building a product at scale is, it's what I'm hearing, it's like obsess about the customer's user journey and follow it every step of the way. But I want to pick up on something. It sounds like you're going even further than that, that this should be like a continuous check-in for anyone building product. I mean, what are some of the essential things you should always be checking when you're scaling your product, when you're really following those journeys?
I think it's important to, and this is related also to when you scale up, is related also to IT architecture, not only to business. You have to first check the journey. There are pain mm-hmm. points. Also from the product perspective, you have to see there is something new. Maybe you should change the product. We all the time we focus to improve one product to be more efficient, more user friendly. But at some point you have to ask the question, do you really need to offer this product? Clients do, maybe there is a bit better product to offer and to cancel completely that specific service or product. This is one thing. But also from the architectural point of view, the main challenge is to remain flexible. So we had the headache in the past in the banking system with the old system and how to deal with that, because there are some monsters in each and every bank.
Yes.
For the core banking system, for the lending. Yes. Approvals. Yeah.
And Marianne, this is the classic legacy system that old banks and other companies have. So how did you approach it? How did you get through it? How did you get to the new?
What is the beauty of our current times is that we have the API technology that allows us to keep the legacy system working and to start decouple things in order to innovate and to build new things. Now the big question is, and the big challenge is that not to end up in the same level of complexity in the future. So when you start building and designing new product and services, you have to put the question all the time, this will be flexible enough in the future, or we'll end up in the same situation.
Right. Now, this is hugely challenging. What you're talking about right here is the intersection between user experience, business models, and technology. They're all sort of, it's like a collision of complexity, if you will. What advice do you have? Because I'm sure many of the people that are tuning in are facing similar challenges, even if they're not even in finance or banking and insurance. How should we think about managing those forces of the business model, the business rules, intersecting with technology choices and weighing up what the user wants? How do we avoid up with something that truly is better and something that is definitely not complex? Like how would you think about that? What advice do you have?
Yeah, there is no, I don't know. I think there is an answer for each problem and there is a solution for each situation. So something that works for us most probably will not work for others. But what is very important, I think, is common for all the organization is when you start such a transformation, you definitely need the empowerment from the top management. So the top management and the all the board members should be aligned and to be supporter of the transformation. This is very important. Also is to put all the people together and everybody to go in the same direction. I said that we we start from an exotic part of the organization, and we wanted to transform it in a core banking, the core business part. So I think this is the challenge, to how to make everybody part of the success. So after you manage to release this into production and to have the first, to feel the first success, you have to share this success with all the organization, because at the end of the day, all organization work and help to have that success. It's not, there are only some member of the team that they were in the front, but in the end of the day, this was the whole organization. And I'll give an example of George. So indeed, this was a team. It was the first experience of working agile in BCR, which happened many years ago. I think we started in 2016, we started to work on George. So it's not so easy. So it's not a success that come overnight. We also had the good part was that we worked with our colleagues from Vienna. So it was cross-country project. And anyway, we managed to launch into production the MVP. But in order to scale up, you have to put everybody in to be part of the success. Because this one is to develop the IT platform, which is okay, could be done. The more difficult part is how to onboard each and every person from the front office and back office on that philosophy, on that service, in order to be provided to the clients, to learn the clients how to use it, how to have the back end, how to have the support from the contact center, how to get the people from the processes, so the people from the product, because in George there are a lot of product that we have to put in. Yes. So at the end of the day is how you manage to pass this message that is not the success of you, is the success of many. So it's the whole organization that drive that success. So this is related to any transformation. You have to have on board the large majority of people in order to go in the right direction.
What techniques have you found, Marian, very effective in onboarding? I mean, you were mentioning the front office people. I think that's a great example of where people building product don't have to only get the product team on board, they got to get everyone on board. So what techniques have you found work well when we're trying to bring people together, get them aligned, get them excited, get them to participate, and in the end, as you said, share in the success? I mean, what techniques worked well for you?
Not secret in this part, is a lot of work actually, is to communicate a lot, but to communicate a lot that people start to tell you that you are spamming the whole organization, and to discuss with them directly, not only to spam them with messages, but to be there and to be genuine interest in their feedback. So to discuss with them and get feedback and take this feedback into consideration. Doesn't matter if you are talking with the process guy or with the front office advisor, and give them tasks to do, because this is also important. What we manage, and I think it was quite good, is that in the now we are in the phase that the whole organization is designing products and services in digital labs. So it's part of what we did, we have the platform, which is Platform George, is the same team that started building the product years ago, that is working together with the other countries, with Vienna and Czech Republic, and so they have cross-country teams. And this is the digital lab is related to the platform itself, but all the other product and services, they develop products in also in digital labs, and they expose this product through George. So they are working also for George. So now all the bank is working for George when they develop product and services.
And Marian, do you think because you involve such a wide spread of people from the organization, does that lead to their real participation, real contribution? Would you say that that leads to them feeling a much higher sense of ownership of the products, and therefore they can really share in the success of the products?
Yeah, this is the secret, because they're really part of the team. When you feel part of the team, you are not feel left aside is very important. And also is very important, and this is something that we learned in the last years, is how business people, they should understand IT. Yeah. Because this was, I am lucky because I have a IT background, so I started 20 years ago, or more than 20 years ago, as an IT guy in a bank. So I was IT at base. But even me, I have to study all the time to understand what is new in this field, because it's not like 20 years ago. Everything is changing every year.
Yeah.
And also the colleagues from IT, they have to understand business, and they. Is not we are lucky because we are in a field that everybody could understand the banking business from the retail perspective, because they are using a bank.
So this is pretty significant, because what we've heard you talk about so far is really overcoming, it's been a long journey and full of a lot of hard work to actually overcome some of those old systems, to be a little bit more liberated from the legacy systems, to introduce George, to introduce some API services, to share product thinking within the entire organization. So I know at first hand, I've seen you guys and what you are doing to bring the bank into the 21st century. But now that we have that foundation, what I'm very keen to know is, a lot of people, when I told them that you were joining QualiTalks, everyone was like, well, what's next for George? What are these guys going to do next? So tell us, like, what technologies have got you excited? What are you thinking about for the products of the future? What's got your curiosity? What has got you interested? And give us a flavor of where you're looking to take the next level of customer experience.
Yeah, so you go back to the question that I said everybody is putting me, what was next. you mentioned that the experience we have, the experience, your experience with us, and I think this was also one inflection point for us as an organization, because we started 2015 with an agile methodology with George, and it was quite okay, but it was more focused on the delivery, IT delivery of the platform. And we start with you the project related to Casa Mea, and then we see the power of real design thinking methodology put in practice. And after this experience, and after the success of Casa Mea, actually we are working like this for all the product and services. And we also put in place a chapter for the UX UI 2 years ago. That really helps. So this is how we adopt and how we managed to evolve in the organization, and I'm sure that this will follow in the future. So if you ask me what is next, this should be next, how we go a step forward from in this direction, how we improve ourselves in the not only in the delivery part, but also how we identify the right thing to do in the platform. So this is a challenge, because right now we miss some things. But What is important, and I think this is everybody is thinking about, is related to big data and how to transform George in a real robo-advisor, not robo-advisor in the sense that everybody knows, but also to help the client to get insights from his or her data. Mm. We said the following as a philosophy that we are, let's say, we are taking care of people's money, and this is a huge responsibility from our part, but we said that we are also responsible for the people's data. So we have to take care of the people's data, but to take care of the people's data, which is their assets, and we have to give that assets back to the client. The clients have the, you know, in Georgia, they have 7 years history. So there is a lot of data that we have about each and every client. And now the only thing, then this is the challenge, to bring back to that specific data in a format that helps the client.
Yes, because as you've said, you don't want to make it more complex. It must be in service to simplicity, to elegance. And what's quite interesting is we see an intersection between their financial profile and then the data, how they use their money, how they experience money, the patterns inside of the data, and then how you can make the right sort of recommendations at the right time to your customers, which is an incredibly exciting challenge. I guess my follow-up question is, are there particular models, frameworks? Are you getting, are you looking at lean and lean analytics, which kind of starts to play with this? Are you looking at some more data-driven models and how to take value from big data? Tell us, like, do you have a textbook that you is a go-to textbook when you think big data? Give us a sense of how are you going to learn, because it's very much about this continuous growth, isn't it?
Yeah, there is no simple answer for that, and you know it. Actually, we position ourselves as a financial health institution. So what we want to do, and this is all the models that we want to create on the data that we have, is first of all, is to bring data or additional information from all the channels, not only from George. Which is important, because the client is also our philosophy is to move all the daily banking activity through the digital platform, which is happening already. So if you need a cash loan or if you need a credit card, there's no need for you to come to the bank, because it's simple. You understand what the cash loans means. You bring some, you take some money, and you have to bring it back. This is pretty simple. So this will be one transaction in one transaction in George, or you have to make a payment or to whatever. This is something that is happening in George. For a more advanced and more complex product, we would like you to come to the branch in order to have a relevant conversation. For investment, for asset management, even for a mortgage, to have one discussion at the branch, or any other types of transaction or insurance. In that specific point in time, we get additional information about you in the branch. So we have to capture also this information, not for us, but also for you, because we... And this is the most difficult thing, is how to bring all this information to you in a relevant form. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll give an example to, I don't know, if you are paying electricity bill and this is the level that you are paying, and we know that you have 3 rooms apartment or something similar, we also know that the whole population that we have that is paying less than you. So we can give you a hint that, look, you have to do something with your electricity contract, or you are doing something wrong in your home, and it might be the case to change something, or you are keeping too much money or a current account, which is bad for you because the inflation will
erode the interest.
So these kind of things that help you improve your financial life. But it's difficult. It's not easy.
Yeah. Because you're taking your own data, customer data, you're benchmarking it against market data. But then once you have the insight, it's equally as hard. What's the best time and place to present that to the user? Okay. You can't just like throw all these insights at them and hope they work it out. Marian, we're going to go to Q&A in a second. So I encourage all of our audience, if you do have questions, throw them into the Q&A with the questions that are already there. So I encourage that because we will be hitting Marian up with some questions from you, our audience, in a second. But what I wanted to ask is, more from your own personal perspective, Marian, how do you think about learning with so much changing, not only within banking? I mean, just think about you've got within the banking sector, you've got GDPR, you've got open banking, you've got know your customer, you've got all these big programmatic things that you need to understand that affect your business. And of course, we have market competition, we have new technologies. How do you learn? How do you keep up with this? Give us a sense of, you know, the student that is still inside of you, Marianne, how do you keep learning? How do you stay up to date with the right thinking so you can be the very best you can be in your job?
I don't know. I like very much to learn about this field. So I am very passionate of this. So this is no effort from my side. I just finished recently a cybersecurity course, which is you know that when the pandemic started, we had two challenges. One challenge is how to work remotely and how to do everything remotely, which I think most of us, we managed very well to do it. And the other challenge was that we, starting from the first day of the pandemic, the cyber security incidents were growing in all the fields, especially in the health industry. So, I think now our life is moving online. So everything which is related to online should be addressed. And I like them. I like very much the open banking overall concept, not only the PSD2 as a regulation. And I know you guys in Australia are more advanced because it's not touching only the banking industry, but also other industries. Yes. And I think this is the democratization of the services and of the banking. And what we want to do also with the democratization of the financial advice, because it's not for the few with much money, it's for everybody. So this will increase a lot. And I think all these regulations are good. GDPR is, I'm not saying that it's complicated our life. I think it's on the good track. It's also the...
Are you reading books? Like, how do you learn about this? I'm very interested. Like, you know, what I like to do is I like to read work from opinion makers. I do a lot of reading of books. I very deliberately search analysis on YouTube. How do you personally, keep up?
Yeah, personally, I'm reading. I'm trying to read at least one business book per month. And I read a lot of articles from consultants and because I'm exposed to many kind of this kind of information. I'm responsible for the digital platform, and also I'm responsible for the open banking. So I'm, let's say, forced to read all the regulation and all this stuff. I used to listen on podcast in order to read also when I'm away. Yeah. But this I did less in the recent time because I didn't travel. When I used to travel, I was listening all the time.
Yeah, I mean, podcasting is the famous thing you do on the commute, isn't it? Right? Yeah. But there's no commute. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, that's wonderful. So you set yourself the challenge of reading a business book once a month. Would you say that's one of your major practices to always be learning and to growing, this reading once a month?
Yeah, I don't know. To be honest, I not succeeded all the time, but it's very important to try and to track. Yes. Because the second month you didn't manage, something is wrong, you have to focus.
That's right. So what are you reading up on at the moment? Are there particular articles on the web? Are there books that you're reading? Tell us what's on the reading list right now.
Now I'm reading a book which is quite old. Is the history of central bank. Is not related to digital. Is not related to open banking. Is related to.
It sounds intense, Marian. It's the history of central banking.
Yeah, which was quite amazing because it's telling the story of how the central banks were set up in the. Yes. Beginning of the century, last century, and what was how it was the relation between gold and the currencies.
Yeah,
it's quite interesting, but yeah, it's not related.
But that's great. What wonderful context to understand, you know, those post-war agreements, fiat currencies, when we detached from the gold standard, yeah. Even to get right into modern monetary theory, which is just like the most unusual Federal Reserve policy we've ever seen. So that's a book in itself, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, Marian, this has been fantastic. I'm going to ask Amelia, what sort of what themes are you seeing us? What should we see here? Oh, I see. There's a great question here. This one is a good one from Lorena. Lorena asks, what was your experience, Marian, in integrating legal and privacy complexity when you're developing a product? These are tough ones to get into a product, right? The legal considerations, privacy, respecting the fact that users are really in control of their data. How are you thinking about that in the earlier stages of product development?
We have, to be very short on this, we have compliance and the legal advisors in the squads from the beginning. And they are part of the development. And I'll give an example. When we start the digital onboarding project, I think 2 years and a half or 3 years already, the most important team members in that squad was the legal advisor and the compliance advisor and the GDPR. So they were very active at the beginning, and to be part of the team from the beginning to the end.
So the interesting thing is that brings us back to this idea of you giving not just the engineers, not just the product owner, but really getting everyone to really meaningfully participate from the start. And that's a way that you can invite not only, you know, the front office, but it can be compliance, it can be legal, IT infrastructure folks. It sounds like that's really a great recommendation that we can all walk away with as to get the organization on board with scaling a large product, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what else? We've got another couple of great questions. This one's a good one. Which technology available today is having the biggest impact on the future of banking in Romania?
Of the future of banking, I think overall, not only Romania, is the cloud computing and artificial intelligence. This will be the biggest impact in the future. Currently, we have... we passed the period of API development and open banking, which is something that is ongoing process. So this interconnection between a provider of financial services, but also between industries, is something that we already know that is happening. It is an early stage, but this will happen. But in the future, I think cloud computing and artificial intelligence, machine learning, these are things that really banking is the business that is dealing with a lot of data, And in order to be more efficient and more relevant, I think this will be the way.
And it sounds like some of those are going to be key to your strategy of, you know, respecting people's money. But you also added another big takeout for me. It's about the money of your customers, but it's also equally about their data. And I think that's like, as a paradigm, I think that's very powerful. I think it's great. And obviously, if you want to be more than just a place where people bank, it sounds like this idea of giving great advice based on the data, based on their banking, but it's the advice is the future. It may even be that is the thing that determines brand loyalty, preference, market leadership, because as we see all these fintechs come along, I think what you're really pointing us towards that everybody has to step up their game, right? Competition is the highest yet. So this sounds to me like a frame by which you're challenging all of us as we, you know, whether we're building banking products or not. It's really a question of how you present to your customers the value add, the trust, the advice, because just a basic service, particularly in these mature competitive markets, it's just not going to be enough, is it?
Yeah, actually, this is our value that we care most is the trust. So this is the DNA of our business is the trust, and trust is in currently not only related to money, but also related to data. And you know that this will be more and more important in the future. Is also this transparency of the code that is something that is nowadays a big discussion about, and how this transparency and how the code and the social media platform is influencing not only the life of people, but also the democracy. So these are very important questions that we have to address. And this is related to the usage of artificial intelligence. What are the rules behind? Are the rules behind transparent for everybody? So these are the things that we have to put on the table. And these are the challenges that we face in the future. Also, another technology that I really believe that will emerge is the TLT, the distributed ledger technology, the blockchain that I think will be very important at least for the payments, which is quite advanced comparing with what we have right now as a technology. Yeah. The payments should somehow will go in that direction. Also, the related to the security, having distributed nodes.
Distributed.
But we will see.
I think we got time for one more question. We've got some great questions coming in. I wish I could promise everyone that we'll get to them all. I love this one. This is from Leonard. He says, you know, as such pioneers, how do you as a bank deal with failure and this idea of testing and learning? Because, you know, it's a very powerful question, because the context here is banks traditionally don't want to ever make a mistake, do they? Right? But as you're developing new things, how do you bring in the right amount of learning and accepting that something didn't work and moving on and improving? What advice do you have for us when thinking about creating a culture where people want to learn and it's not always going to go right?
Yeah, it's. I think everybody is saying this, that it's okay to fail, but when you fail, disappear.
It's so true. It's like, yeah, we like failure as long as you don't do it.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, it's a process. It's not, you have to start with small things. So there are things in our field that we cannot fail, like compliance, like data security. Like, these are things that I will tell you from now, nobody will say that it's okay, go for this. So you have to be careful what you tell. But this, I think, is a process and is related to the transforming the culture of the organization. I will give an example. When I went to the management board, I think 3-4 years ago, to say, look, guys, we launched George 2.5 years, I think 3 years ago. Look, guys, we will launch George. By the way, we have only 80% of the functionality that the old net banking platform has. But it's okay because it's very cool, very user experience. People, we have the 80% of the functionalities, but are the functionalities that they really use. And this is, how come? No. You tell us that you launch an application with less functionalities and the people will like more than old one. Yeah, I said, yeah, let's try this. It was a very difficult and painful exercise to go further. But we are learning from this process. So we are getting trust between us. That is
trust on the inside so you can have trust on the outside. Well, Marianne, I think that is the perfect note for us to wrap up our conversation. I think we've covered some great ground here. I'm looking at all my notes, but you know, I love this idea of it always starts with the user and the value you're creating with them. And this point that you made about it's not just their money, it's their data. I mean, that's huge, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a big one. It's a real big one. And then obviously getting everyone in the organization to contribute, that means they all feel like they own it. They can share in the success. And I think this is what you've shared with us is so much insight and wisdom to how you've been part of this journey with all of your teammates in taking all of the best of BCR in the past and giving it a huge turbo boost into the future. So it's really been great to learn from you, Marianne. So I want to thank you. I've really appreciated the time, particularly as you've done this on your vacation. So I hope you've enjoyed it. How did you find it?
Yeah, thank you very much for having me. And it was a real pleasure. And I enjoy very much our discussions. So it was like for me a discussion between you and me because I cannot see the others, but I feel them somewhere.
It's just our usual chat, Marianne. Yeah, it's just our usual chat.
I enjoy a lot. So it was a perfect way to start my holiday.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for all the advice and the wisdom. And to everybody that's listening at home or in the office, I want to thank you for joining us for the rejuvenation of QualiTalks. We might be in a webinar, but I'll tell you what, this was as good as Professor Dan Cordes from Georgetown University. This was as good as all the classic QualiTalks that I know that you love. And I really want to thank you for giving us your time. I hope you've enjoyed some of the ideas that we have shared with you today. I want to ask all of you to send us your feedback. We're really keen to learn from you as we go into this new format. How can we produce the best learning content? How can we really bring to you the best thinking that's possible? Today, we've been very lucky to have our partner from BCR, Marian Ignat. It has been such a joy to go and talk with an old friend about how we can survive in what feels like an ever-changing world. But stay tuned, because this time next month, we will be sharing with you the results of our emerging trends survey. So we have hundreds of people all around the world who are building products, working with technology, sharing with us their learnings, not only about emerging trends in technology, but also some fascinating insights about how we collaborate too. So I'm going to be unpacking that with a very special guest, with one of our fabulous partners. So I can't wait to share with you all of those insights. So stay tuned, because in just 4 weeks' time, we will be sharing with you our emerging trends report. And I'm really excited to do it. So don't forget to give us your feedback. Don't forget to send us your suggestions and your ideas. And I'm really excited to start this journey of learning together here on QualiTalks in 2021.